former NFL defensive back, former NFL scout, Panthers and Seahawks. Okay, so Josh Rosen, you enter the day, Bucky Brooks, NFL Network analyst, at the 15th pick, and you don't have a lot of cachet to move up. Buffalo had a lot of picks. I thought Buffalo had a good day. So Buffalo had a lot of picks to move up. Arizona's like, we don't, and we need a quarterback, and you end up with Josh Rosen. They had to be doing cartwheels.
Oh, they absolutely have to be. The thing, they could get a franchise quarterback where they were sitting and not give up much to get him. They absolutely won the day in that vein. Josh Rosen is a perfect fit for them. He's in the perfect location. What they're going to do with him, I think, will elevate his game, and he will elevate the team. One, you have a quarterback who is going to a place that already has a franchise receiver in Larry Fitzgerald. Even though he's on the downslope, if you look at the common denominator with Carson Wentz and Jared Goff, they have veteran pass catchers, dependable. That'll help him because he has consistency on the outside. David Johnson is one of the top two, three running backs in the league.
No question.
He can do it not only as a runner but as a receiver.
Yes.
He always has a security blanket to lean on when things get tight. Now, they still need to add some more pieces on the outside, but in terms of play caller, head coach, system, playing on the West Coast, it is perfect for Josh Rosen. It's really aggressive, but I'm going to give you some context. Josh Rosen was the number one and number two ranked recruit in the country when he came out. Five-star recruit. He had to sit in the green room and watch a two-time walk-on go ahead of him. He had to watch a guy with one offer who was a JC transfer go ahead of him, and then he had to watch his crosstown rival go ahead of him. No matter who you are, when you see that, you're going to be in your feelings a little bit,
sure,
which is what he was.
Yeah.
I think the one thing that I would have probably advised him, internalize it, don't verbalize it.
Right.
Because now that soundbite kind of lingers. But I've talked to some people who we all did the Elite 11 tour with him, and it may help him a little bit because it's the first time that he is kind of the underdog, the guy that's kind of been thrown to the back of the bus. He will be a better player because of it, because he ends up going to a better situation maybe than some of them, and he's going to be motivated to work. And we've seen the Brady Six. We've seen how Brady can recount all of those guys. Tom Brady, that
no,
is.
No, that bitterness never
all
leaves.
All of those guys. So that chip on your shoulder, it never goes away. And I know some people say, hey, he's still a top 10 pick. Yeah, but he's the fourth quarterback. And he always will tell you, I'm the fourth quarterback. I was the 11th receiver taken. I can name them all. That stuff doesn't it doesn't go away. And so for him, he will always be motivated every day to know that I was the fourth quarterback taken in a class that was supposed to be known for the quarterbacks.
So I was in the Chargers room last night. One of the two things, well, I'll get to it later, but you know, fans like touchdowns and celebrations and wide receivers, and the Cowboys, everybody's going, take Calvin Ridley, take Calvin Ridley. And Dallas over the last several years didn't take Johnny Manziel, they took Zach Martin. I've been saying this now for the last year or two. I think Dallas knows what they're doing. So they take a linebacker last night, and everybody's like, ah, who, guy play eight-man football. Calvin Ridley was out there. What did you see with that pick?
Well, what I saw with that pick is Rob Marinelli had influence on the pick. Rob Marinelli must see Leighton Vander Esch as Brian Urlacher.
Okay.
And when we did the numbers, the research team brought up the numbers from the combine. That's the comparable that spit out. Brian Urlacher, this guy is big, 6'4", 245, 250 pounds, can run like the wind, super athletic. Everyone has seen the clips of him slam dunking and doing all that stuff.
Right.
When you think about the way that they want to play defense, they want to play that Tampa 2 style, and now Chris Richard comes over, they're probably blending some of the stuff in Seattle. The common denominator, the guy that plays in the middle needs to be long, athletic, and rangy. Well, that's what Leighton Vander Esch is. And also, you're always building your team to win the division. Well, what is going down in the division? You have teams that can now run the football. You saw Philadelphia. They were third in rushing. You saw what the New York Giants did when they get Saquon Barkley. You have to have people that can defend the offenses that you have to win, because the easiest way to get to the playoffs is to win the division. The Cowboys made a move to win the division. The other thing that goes with that, a lot of people wanted to see pass catchers go off the board in round one. Since 2015, the last 13 receivers that were taken in the first round, only one has gone to the Pro Bowl. That's Amari Cooper. So I've heard you talk about wide receivers being the icing on the cake.
I think it's brilliant.
That's a little disrespectful to the spot. But I will say it's a little more systematic. You can build an offense with guys that fit a certain system and have success. Juju Smith-Schuster, went in the second round, had immediate success. the way your play callers, play designers can craft their systems, you can get guys that aren't necessarily marquee guys to have a lot of production on the outside.
Bucky Brooks, former player, Seahawks, scout for them, and the Panthers. I love having him on the show. There's Lamar Jackson's interesting. I actually think for kind of an outwardly dull franchise, he'll be beloved immediately. I mean, Flacco plays dull and is dull. And it's an organization that's been special teams and defense. So I think just emotionally, the town will love him. Secondly, is Flacco doesn't get hurt. If he goes to Arizona with Sam Bradford week two start, I think he and Josh Allen both need a year. My takeaway has always been Darnold and Rosen and Baker can actually play. I don't love Baker, but he can play quickly. I think Josh Allen, who I really don't love, and Lamar Jackson, just give him a year or two. So I like the Baltimore thing. Now, just because they draft him, a lot of people draft quarterback. I mean, Belichick drafts one every year. Is Lamar their future?
I think so. I think this is part of a long-term play. And I think the way they did it, if you really looked at what they were doing, they dropped the little breadcrumbs. If you followed the trail, you knew that Lamar Jackson was in play. When they signed RG3 a couple weeks ago, immediately I thought, they're getting a quarterback, a backup quarterback that can run the same system as a dual-threat quarterback. So then when you see the visit, Lamar Jackson goes into Baltimore, that's kind of odd. They have Joe Flacco. That doesn't work. Well, now, remove Joe Flacco. Lamar Jackson, RG3. You could say they have similar skill sets. So when you rebuild this offense and rebuild a team around Lamar Jackson, if Lamar Jackson goes out, RG3 can come in, and you don't have to do the radical overhaul of the offense. For so long, when you've had dual-threat quarterbacks or mobile playmakers, if he gets hurt, the backup doesn't have the same skill set. Well, now in Baltimore, potentially, you have a quarterback one and a quarterback two. They have similar skill sets. So now the offense can run as scheduled.
Yeah, here's what's going to happen. So Flacco was one. They didn't know at the time before the Super Bowl run if they were going to go with Flacco because he drove him crazy. Then he wins the Super Bowl. They pay him. So here he's driven him crazy since then. Now next year's his last guaranteed year. I think to your point, Bucky, they've been burned by him. They're not going to do it again. They know what Joe Flacco is, which is a guy who can turn it on and be magic, but it's situational. He's not obsessed like Russell Wilson. He's not obsessed like Brady. I think they're moving on to Lamar.
Oh, absolutely. They're going to move on. He's in the last year to deal. They don't have any long-term tie commitment. And also, what they've seen is they gave Joe Flacco $20-plus million. So when you start paying the quarterback $20 million, you begin to expect the quarterback to mask all the other flaws because I'm paying you to be the Febreze. You're the deodorizer to make sure that all the other stuff that stinks, you mask. He doesn't do that. And so for the Baltimore Ravens, look, if Joe Flacco plays well this year, great. They give him a parting gift. They move on. Lamar Jackson is the future for the Baltimore Ravens as their starting quarterback.
I didn't like the Baker Mayfield pick. Tell me your thoughts.
I wasn't in love with it. I am growing to just accept it, and I found out about it earlier, so I didn't have the shock on draft day. Here's what I'll say about Baker Mayfield and why the Cleveland Browns may have thought. John Dorsey, Scott McLuhan, Alonzo Highsmith, Elliott Wolf, they all worked there. Where we all worked together in Green Bay when Brett Favre was in the middle of a great three straight MVP run in the mid-90s. Scott McLuhan in the fall said that Baker Mayfield reminded him of Brett Favre. The swag, the confidence, the way that he kind of plays the game, the way that he gravitates towards his teammates, the way that he plays in big moments. So they bought into the it factor that is Baker Mayfield. Now, I've always said Baker Mayfield needs to go to a team where the supporting cast can elevate him. He is not necessarily the elevator. When I look at Cleveland on paper, they have a team that can do that. Josh Gordon is an all-pro player when he's healthy and right. Jarvis Landry is a Pro Bowl player. David Njoku, first-round pick, can control the middle of the field. They bring over Carlos Hyde to be the banger to run it. They're probably going to draft another running back early in this draft. Now you look at their offensive line, I say you can give them a B-plus offensive line. Well, all Baker Mayfield has to do is just connect the dots. The challenge will be, when I looked at Baker Mayfield last summer, I compared him to Tyrod Taylor. I said he was not as explosive as Tyrod, but basically you're getting Tyrod Taylor.
Right.
So now when they line up on the field together, will Baker Mayfield outshine Tyrod Taylor?
I think it's a coin flip.
Tyrod Taylor is not going to give him the competition because he went to Buffalo and he sucked up E.J. Manuel. He took all the air out of the room because he's an alpha personality. So now you got two alphas going. Tyrod Taylor is going to make Baker Mayfield win that job from him. We'll see if it can happen.
We just moved over to Fox Sports Go. Great seeing you, Bucky Brooks. Thanks, bud.
Thanks for having me.
Love having you. Hi, everybody. Thanks for watching. Subscribe here to get the latest from the show. Also, be sure to check out more of the best clips from The Herd or go watch a few segments from other shows on FS1.